I'm your host, Josh Powers, and I want to let you in on how unique this program is here at Cox Studio. All of our production crew are all young adults on the autism spectrum, and they're all doing a fantastic job here, so we want to thank them. And now please welcome my
financial needs. So really, no matter whether you have a child with special needs or a typical child, you really ought to be planning as soon as you start a family.
Mm-hmm. Now you were mentioning, you know, death can be a huge factor, but also I was looking through some statistics that we were talking before the show, and you said this is the most shocking thing to me, that 75% of parents with children on the spectrum or special needs, I think in general, divorce. 75% of parents divorce.
And that's most unfortunate, but it is reality. Mm-hmm. And divorce in any family creates a difficult situation, but it does more so in a family with special needs, because there can be multiple families and multiple situations which complicates what's going to happen to a child with special needs going into the future. And the fact that there is such a high incidence of divorce makes us, our families, particularly vulnerable to financial setbacks.
Mm. And how does the divorce of it, I mean, we were even talking about, you may have financial planning all set up, and the second divorce happens, at least in the state of Connecticut, it basically kind of terminates everything. So how does divorce make things really messy in that sense?
You know, when I started talking about financial planning, I said it's a process. And any time you make a plan, you really have to think of it as a work in progress. Mm-hmm. Things change, your child becomes an adult, their needs change, and you get new information and new development. And so you always have to move forward with an eye towards amending things as things change. Divorce in the state of Connecticut, you can be the most organized person, you can have trusts and you can have wills, but in the state of Connecticut, as soon as there is a divorce, any will that you have established becomes null and void. So that would apply whether you had any children, a special needs child or otherwise, but it is important to know that you may think that you have it done, then perhaps you become part of that statistic where 75% of us have gone through a divorce, and all of a sudden, very quickly, you don't have a will when you think you do. So when there's nobody who stands there and says to you, gee, did you know, when you get that divorce, that also nullified your will, and that's unfortunate because most people don't know it until it's after the fact.
Too late.
Mm-hmm.
Too late. So are there agencies or are there other organizations to help to assist with this financial planning?
There's not enough. In the state of Connecticut, there's a group called PLAN, and they'll help with trusts and wills. They're a nonprofit organization, and they can be helpful. But in general, agencies are not really designed to provide this kind of information and assistance. Mm-hmm. Most of the time you have to go to a private attorney, to assist you as you go through this process. But PLAN is a very reliable and helpful resource in the state of Connecticut.
Now you say attorney, which is a very important part of the process, what you were telling me before. Do you think a big part of people not wanting to do this possibly is the money? Because you say attorney and you automatically think cost.
Well, there's a move. As I talk to people about estate planning and financial, you know, advising in my business, one of the things that is a recent trend is that everybody wants to go online and punch in will and mm-hmm. print out a will, and they think they have a will. That can work even in a typical situation, but it doesn't work with special needs planning. Each state is very different in the way they have their program set up, and therefore any trusts that you establish with the objective of meeting the requirements to be effective in the state of Connecticut has to be custom made in the state of Connecticut. So you really do have to go to an attorney. An attorney is going to charge, all attorneys are different, but it's very important to find an attorney who has expertise in special needs planning, because it is a unique and specialized practice. And a mistake in your trust can have significant financial ramifications for your child.
Okay, and that's seems why the percentages you gave before, you said 38% of people have wills, you know, who have kids with special needs, and 21% have trusts. You know, a will, like you said, can be done online very simply, usually. Mm-hmm. And a trust, you need an attorney, and not only that, but a special needs attorney that really knows.
And there are lots of people. The first time I went and got a trust myself, I went to an attorney who was a general attorney. And although he did establish a trust for me, it was not the right kind of trust for Medicaid planning. Mm. So it is very important to get somebody who understands all the provisions of the different state codes and mm-hmm. requirements to meet the requirements to be eligible for Medicaid, which is the goal. The reason that you would have a trust is that you want your child to be able to take advantage of federal programs that are offered. Those federal programs are not offered to everybody. There has to be a financial need. If you don't establish a trust and a child or an adult has money in their name, then the government is not going to be in a position to step in and provide programs for your child. So you still want to have money there to assist them so that they can live a happy life. Money is important in terms of not only your survival needs, but your personal happiness. So you want the trust to be there so that they can have financial resources, but you don't want those assets to make them ineligible for federal benefits. Mm-hmm. And those benefits, both state and federal, are critical to the success of your child going forward and their happiness.
Mm. Now, we've talked about kind of processes and getting help for this, and there's nothing horribly solid to get help as far as financial planning goes, and especially free. But ASRC has started to kind of, and I know you've kind of headed this up since you're so involved, but what is ASRC offering, and how is that going to be so beneficial to parents?
So I've been doing this for as part of my own work for years. And it became clear to me over time that there was a unique situation for families with children with special needs, and that at the same time, there was a great deal of hesitance. People mm-hmm. didn't know. It seems so complicated. It's hard to understand. I know for myself, even though I was in the business, when I really said to myself, I have to draw a line in the sand, focus on this, do it. And I'm just like everybody else. I didn't do it when he was born. I didn't really do it until he was a preteen. But when I then decided, okay, I have to learn about it, it was really hard for me. And this is what I do. So I think that I've been talking about it for years, just dismayed at how much effort it took for me, who has a basic understanding, to get the lay of the land, to understand the government programs, to understand the interplay of personal assets and eligibility, that I just decided that I needed to commit some time to educating other people about it. So we've been talking about it, and now ASRC is beginning to look at making it a part of transition planning. Because as we talk about how a child ages, becomes a young adult, and then an adult in society, their financial well-being is critical to their future success. So we're hoping, as we talk about transition from school, from high school to post-high school to secondary, that we devote some part of the curriculum to helping parents get motivated to look at the financial issues as well.
Okay. Now, as I was kind of learning about your background, you said you've been through the learning curve yourself. You're very committed to helping others because you've been there, helping them get parents get the info that they need in a simpler, more straightforward way, you were saying, more so than you were even able to get yourself. And I know you've said to me that you were in the business and it was extremely difficult even for you. And I think even in just the last month, you've had this very difficult time. Could you describe that and maybe what you've learned from that?
Okay, well, I'll talk about my personal experience was that I decided my child was maturing over time and things were a little easier for me, and I decided that I wanted to give back in some way. So I became more actively involved in ASRC and some things at the state level, and I started attending meetings. And the first thing I was amazed at is finding out all the things I didn't know. And sitting in a room and having people talk in acronyms and speaking in a way that I just didn't understand. And I'm a communicator. I communicate in my practice at work, and I used to be a teacher. And I just was struck by how much effort it took personally for me to really feel at some point that I could be confident that I understood all the moving parts. And there are so many moving parts, because you're really dealing with someone's total life. You're dealing with their work life, their educational life, their financial life, and their future. And you're interfacing with government agencies that always present obstacles to having people get a perfect understanding of the situation. And so informally, I would speak with others, and I would begin to feel that my ability to communicate was helping other people understand, which is great. So you'd sit in a room, and then people would just kind of, you know, pick my brain and say, well, what does this mean, and how does this work? And it was fun. It was exciting to share that information with other people, and I felt that I was empowering them. And I also felt that I kind of had things under control. I had done my own planning. Mm-hmm. I was married at the time, and we went through the process. We were both committed to making sure that our son had every opportunity to exceed and excel in life and have a happy life, and that the money would not be an obstacle if we could avoid it. So we did the trust, we did the insurance, we did the wills, we went the whole nine yards, we established, we did a letter of intent, which is very important, which says, you know, little quirks and things that people ought to know about your child, puts it all in one place. And then we unfortunately parted ways, and the plan kind of fell apart, and both of us were busy living our own lives, and my ex-husband did not get his will done immediately after the divorce, and he recently remarried, and he has passed away, and he passed away very unexpectedly. And we are now, like many other people, running around, all of us, trying to figure out how we put the pieces together, even though we thought we had. So not only do you have to understand the process, and you have to do the work to get the plan, you have to have the commitment and the discipline to update it on a regular basis. Because even though you think that you are invincible and nothing's going to happen, mm-hmm. and you have all your ducks in a row, sometimes fate happens and it doesn't work that way. And being someone now who's trying to follow up and put it all back together, because that's the intent. We liked the way it was. We were happy with the plan. We now want to reestablish it after the fact. It's so much more complicated. It's just so much easier if you put the intentions all down, you map it out. It doesn't require that you devote your lifetime to it, but it's a lot easier and more time effective if you do it in advance and have it all set up just in case something happens. Because when something happens, there's all those emotions and there's all those complications, and it's just easier if there's a roadmap.
Mm. Now, you said you learned many lessons, and I don't want you to name a ton. I won't make you do that. But even if it was just the top three or the top two, what would be your top learned lesson that you would like to share with someone else going through something similar?
The first thing I did when I realized that things were in disarray is I wrote a letter that detailed everything. So I had all the pieces in my head. My ex-husband did. We were partners in wanting the best, but we both had the information just in our own heads, never thinking that something would happen to one of us. And then when something happens to one of you, something can happen to the other as well. Mm-hmm. So I spent an evening just writing it all out. And then I started pulling papers together, putting them all in one place, making sure that I did write down who's the attorney that I worked with, that we worked with, who's the financial advisor. Now, I'm my own financial advisor. Sorry, I'm my own financial advisor, but if I'm not there, who's going to take over that responsibility? And then just sitting down with the people who were responsible, my daughter for one, and my son has two siblings from a previous marriage, and just making sure that everybody understood all the moving parts, because even though it seems simple to me, it's not to someone who doesn't do it for a living. So I had to give everybody a basic education. So I wrote it out, I gave people a basic education, and I gathered everything together so that if something does happen, which we all hope it does not, everything is in one place.
So what I've gathered is that not just for parents to do the financial planning, but this can oftentimes be a family affair. You know, it can involve grandparents or even more than that. If there's a chance that those family members could leave something for that child with special needs, is that correct?
That's absolutely true. As in all aspects of raising a child on the spectrum, I've often said it takes a village. And no one lives in isolation, and it's very important that all family members are brought into the planning process, because inadvertently, in an effort to help your child, perhaps leave your child with a legacy, grandparents, aunts, uncles, all sorts of other related people could say, gee, you know, I would like to bequeath something for your child in my will. If they do that, it can potentially upset the eligibility of that child. So as I look at my own situation, we've put together both private programs and public programs that support my son and that have enabled him to flourish. He's doing great. So what happens if somebody passes away and they, out of, as I said, the goodness of their heart, they leave him with $25,000? In a typical situation, that's just a wonderful gift, and you're very grateful for it. But with a child with special needs, what happens is it could potentially disqualify them for benefits and disrupt that intricate program that you've put together that is really resulting in them having a much better life. So you have to get everybody to understand that if they're going to leave money for your child, they must leave it into a special needs trust.
And like we know, $25,000 sounds like a lot, but when you're dealing with those programs, that's a drop in the bucket.
You're allowed to have very little money in $1,200, $1,300, something like that, and maintain your eligibility for Medicaid. And for all of us that live in this world, you know that that doesn't go very far, and certainly doesn't go far over a lifetime. So it is very, very important to have some extra finances in a trust that can be used to supplement the aid and supplement the personal needs of that child.
Now, how does the level of functionality of a child, either on the spectrum or with a special need, affect planning for their future? Does that have a big role?
Well, I think, you know, when I look at my own situation, that was one of the reasons that we hesitated, because we weren't quite sure what he was going to need. And we've been delighted that he's doing so well that I think he needs a lot less than we had feared for a long time. But the more support that your child needs as they age, the more support that you're going to have to finance, because as we all know, government dollars are in very short supply, and there's a good likelihood that your child will not get the full amount that they need, especially if their needs are acute. So you have to look at what kinds of supports they're going to need on a long-term basis. You're going to have to project a little bit and make some assumptions. But as in any kind of planning, it's almost impossible to fully fund for all your needs. But you want to have a good idea of how much you'll need so that you can at least make an attempt to meet that objective.
Okay. And other than when certain circumstances like divorce or something like that comes up, how often and why should you revisit these plans? Is that important as well?
Well, yes. I think periodically everybody ought to review the plan, because laws change, and we know that better than anybody. But again, if there's any significant family event, I not only did mine after the divorce, I did it again when my daughter turned 18, because that changed the landscape, and she became more of a partner in the program. And so with that being the case, I added her and made her a trustee and made her one of the executors of the estate. So you do it when there are significant family events, and you do it on a regular basis just because things change. And a good attorney will say to you, oh, gee, when was the last time you reviewed that? nothing new has happened in terms of the laws. As long as your personal situation hasn't changed, I don't think we have to rewrite it. My document was done in 2007, and it still stands
today.
And
it's good. Mm-hmm. We don't have much time left, but I just want to know that if you were talking to a mother, for example, because I know you can relate, with someone on a child on the spectrum, and she was struggling or hesitating to do this, or what would you say in one or two sentences to that mother?
I would say that when I did it, the weight of the world was lifted off my shoulders, and that especially now that I am the single parent remaining for my son, even though everybody's a little nervous when I drive and whether I text and drive and do all those kinds of things, and I sort of feel like everybody wants me living in a bubble, I know that if something happened to me tomorrow, that they would be okay. Mm-hmm. And any mother wants to know that. That's
a big comfort. Indescribable.
Really, you can't quantify it. Indescribable, you can't quantify it. And it took the weight of the world off my shoulders. Did it solve all my problems? No, nothing solves all your problems. But it really helped to give me peace of mind.
Well, thank you for sharing all of this. I appreciate it. And I know a lot of people at home have been able to connect with you, and I'm sure they can use all that they've learned. If you want to find out more, you can always go to our website, ASRC's website. It's www.ct-asrc.org. I want to thank Shira for being with us and all of our crew and everyone that helps out every time we do this show. We'll see you next time, everybody. Bye-bye.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. You are only waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird, fly. Blackbird, fly. Into the line of a dark black night. Dark black night.